Well, Kingsley, let me start by saying that I want to thank you for that rather understated introduction. When I received an initial call from Kingsley about this particular event, obviously for reasons that may become obvious later, he said to me, have you got any action films or photographs of your rugby career? Now, for those of you who know me, you may find this a rather odd request. In the first instance, I wasn't known for action. And if there was any action in my rugby playing career, I hope it wasn't evident to anybody, particularly the referee. But secondly, I didn't expect, and nor were there ever, any photographers at any rugby match that I ever played in. But it was nice to be thought of in this rather flattering way, and I can only assume that Kingsley in his period in the United States either smoked or something else. And I'm very glad to be associated with some of the icons of Irish rugby that should and will be honoured, I hope, this evening. But I have, I must confess, over the years, imagined myself as a great Irish rugby player. I have even dreamt of myself as a great Irish rugby player. And I continue to do it to this day. And in fact, I frankly believe I should have been a great Irish rugby player. This issue of imagination and rugby reminded me of the story of President Brezhnev in the early 1980s. President Brezhnev was about to pay a visit to Poland, and he called in Popov, his chef de cabinet, and he said to Popov, "Popov," he said, I need, he said, a portrait of Lenin in Poland for my next visit to Poland. I want to present it to the comrades in Poland." And Popov remained silent for a second and then said, "But I'm afraid we can't produce such a portrait because Lenin never visited Poland." Brezhnev remained silent for a second and he said, "Well, in that case, get a portrait painter from somewhere with imagination who can paint Lenin in Poland." So Popov said, "Okay," and he went off. First of all, he said that there was no portrait painter, he thought, with imagination. They were all in the gulag. The only painters that were left were KGB copiers, but he would try to find a painter in the gulag. So after about 2 months, he came back with Medvedev from the gulag, who had been cleaned up and presented to President Brezhnev. And Brezhnev said to him, he said, "Mr. Medvedev," he said, "I will release you from the gulag if you do a painting for me of Mr. Lenin visiting Poland." Medvedev paused for a second and he said, "But the problem is that Lenin never visited Poland." But he said, "Forget about that. You're a man with imagination. Go off and do the painting." 3 months passed. Medvedev came back and he presented this painting, shrouded. Brezhnev sitting looking at it, and the shroud is removed. And Brezhnev looks at it with horror and he sees a couple in flagrante delicto in the painting. And he said, "Who is that man?" And Medvedev said, the man is Trotsky. "And who's that woman?" "That's Lenin's wife." "And where is Lenin?" And he said, "Lenin is in Poland." Well, when I was asked to speak, I was asked to speak briefly. And I said I would speak briefly, and I think Kingsley said, "You're a brick," but he might have said something else. But we're not here to discuss artistic license. We're here to celebrate a particular charity. And in that context, let me make a comment about voluntary giving. As you may know, in recent times, there have been a number of very prominent individuals, Bill Gates, to take one example, and Warren Buffett another, who have been associated with giving. And this is something which is clearly catching on, because during the course of the last week, David Miliband, the Minister for Environment in the UK, has been commenting on the fact that those who have been receiving massive bonuses in the City of London should be giving more. And I understand that during the week, one of his civil servants rang a very well-known fund manager to ask him to make a donation to charity. And he made the comment to him that he was aware of the fact that this man had received incalculable sums of money over the preceding year or two and hadn't donated a penny piece to any charity. And he asked him, surely you would now like to give something to charity and something substantial to that effect. And the fund manager said, first of all, he said, I'd like to ask you a question. Did your advisors inform you that my mother is living alone, she's incapacitated, requires major attention, which is way beyond her means to provide, and during the course of the last year, she has had to be supported? No, says the civil servant, I didn't know that. And he said, with the decibel count rising further, he said, did you know anything about my brother? He's a war veteran. He was damaged in Iraq. He can't move. He's being looked after year in, year out. What about that? Well, the civil servant said, I didn't know about that. And what about my sister, he said? Her husband was killed in a motor accident, 3 children, left alone, unsupported by anybody. What about that? Well, said the civil servant, I must say I'm taken aback by this information. I didn't know any of it. I thought not, he said. Well, if I didn't give anything to any of them, why should I give anything to you? But after that rather infradig story, let me say to you something very briefly about the Ireland Fund of Great Britain, which is joint host to you this evening. During the 1940s, the 1950s, the 1960s, and even the 1970s, enormous amounts of support for this country, during periods when we were on our knees, were provided by those who had emigrated during the period of the war and immediately after the war. People who had worked building roads, digging tunnels, providing agricultural support to potato picking or whatever in the UK. And many of these people have become the forgotten people. And this is a famous fact as a result of a very good documentary that was shown on Irish television, and indeed is the subject matter of some support from the Irish government. But there are huge problems in the Irish community in Britain. The Ireland Fund of Great Britain provides support for literally hundreds of organisations, all of which are too small to raise money on their own behalf. Small, local, often parochial organisations which help those who are damaged and in difficulty. And the difficulties that they suffer are today the price that is paid for our failure as a society for a very prolonged period of time to provide them with a living or an opportunity. There's a house, for an example, in London called Arlington House. Arlington House still contains a large number of Irish people. It's what's called a wet house. It's a wet house because people are allowed to continue drinking in it. And the condition that you find there and the people that you find there are people who are at the very bottom of the pile. And we in Ireland have a bit of an obligation to them, particularly those of us here tonight who have enjoyed not merely successful careers here, but particularly have enjoyed successful careers in the United Kingdom, which has entertained us, maintained us, and promoted us through difficult times without reference to our provenance or home. And it's this group of deprived Irish people who over a period of a couple of decades provided over 3 billion of remittances to Ireland to help to sustain us, that we have a bit of an obligation too. They're forgotten, they're called the Forgotten Irish, but the Ireland Fund in Great Britain is trying to raise a substantial amount of money to deal with their interests and their concerns. So I have no hesitation this evening in bluntly putting it to you that there is an obligation to help, that we need the help, that the people who are there are people who deserve our help, and that the Ireland of today, this amazingly prosperous and successful society, a society which has gone from a position in 1991 where the average GDP of Ireland was 67% of the EU average to a figure today of over 144%. A staggering, phenomenal success that carries with it a burden of responsibility. And those of you here today particularly who have an association with Britain, I would ask you to be associated with us in moving forward, because the umbrella that is provided by the Ireland Fund is something that can't be duplicated. These small organisations cannot themselves raise money. And you can be assured that the people who are dedicated, far more dedicated than I am, to the actual application of these funds are actually going to deliver real prospects and some sort of happy future, often for people at the end of their lives. So I ask you in conclusion, not merely to be supportive by being with us here this evening, but also to be supportive with us in the future in trying, in the UK sense, to deal with people from both north and south who have been deprived in Britain of the sort of support that we have a moral obligation to provide. Thank you very much indeed.